mistake to remain in the works of Abu Hanifa. Why? Because he had masters in qiyas like Zufar, Muhammad and Abu Yusuf with him. He had masters in hadith like Yahya ibn Abi Zaidah and Hafs ibn Ghiyas with him. He had masters in the Arabic language like Qasim with him. And he had people like Fuzail ibn Iyas who nobody could match in piety and taqwa. He says that whoever's companions are these type of people, he cannot make a mistake. And if he does make a mistake, then these people, رُضُّوهَ إِلَى الْحَقِّ, they will turn him to the truth. So these were the type of people Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah had chosen to compile the fiqh. Now how he compiled the fiqh was that he would relate a problem to his students. And the problem, and the students would solve, try to solve this problem. And the sources they used to solve the problem, yet again, was the Qur'an. If not found in the Qur'an, the sunnah of Rasulullah. If not the sunnah, third came the ijma of the sahaba, the unanimous agreement of the sahaba. If not from there, then the individual opinion of a sahabi. If not from there, then came qiyas, analogical deduction. After qiyas came istihsan, preference. After istihsan came urf, local custom. This is the sources that they used to solve their problems. Now if all the masters came to one solution, this solution was recorded by Imam Abu Yusuf and Yahya ibn Abi Zaidah. However, if the masters could not come to an agreement, could not solve the problem, unanimously come to one agreement, then this debate would continue. And sometimes it would go on for months. Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah throughout would listen to the different opinions of the masters. If it prolonged too much, then Abu Hanifa would come with such a solution that all the masters would agree. And this solution was recorded. However, even after the solution of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah, the masters differed, then all the different opinions would be recorded. And sometimes when a very difficult masla would arrive and it was solved, all the masters, Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah, would recite the takbir, Allahu Akbar. Like this, in a period of 22 years, Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah with 40 masters compiled the fiqh. And these books were known as the books of Abu Hanifa. And every time a portion was written, the books were spread throughout the country. Right? And this is how the madhab Abu Hanifa got stronger and stronger. To the extent, it is said that the masail of Abu Hanifa reached 500,000. Now, only after this fiqh was compiled, Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah gave permission to his students to take on positions as judges. And his students took on positions as judges, and they would also rule according to the Hanafi madhab. And this is how the Hanafi madhab became accepted throughout the world and became stronger and stronger because of the work that Imam Abu Hanifa had did and the work his students did thereafter. This was the first school of thought. The second school of thought that came into being and was formed was the Maliki school of thought. Now I mentioned that many Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in resided in Madinat al-Munawwara. Now one of the great personalities was Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhum. From the Sahaba that resided in Madinat al-Munawwara, like the likes of Abdullah ibn Umar, it was from these Sahaba, what we call the Fuqaha'i Sab'a, the seven jurists acquired their knowledge of Medina. The seven jurists of Medina acquired their knowledge from the Sahaba who had acquired it from Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. From these seven jurists, people like Abu Zinad, Nafi, Mawla Abdullah ibn Umar, and Ibn Shahab acquired their knowledge. And from these people, the likes of these people, Imam Malik rahimullah acquired his knowledge. And this is how the Maliki madhab goes back to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. Now Imam Malik rahimullah spent 50 years giving fatwa and giving lectures on hadith. Unlike the Hanafis in Iraq, Imam Malik did not concentrate on hypothetical problems. He only would give answers to problems which had arose. And the way he would solve his problems, yet again, and I keep on repeating this, so that you know that each and every madhab goes back to the Qur'an and Sunnah. He would look at the Qur'an, number one. Then in the Qur'an, second would come the Sunnah. Third would come the ta'amul of the people of Medina, the practices of the people of Medina. Fourth would come the ijma of the Sahaba. Fifth would come the different opinions of the Sahaba. After this would come the customs of the people of Medina. After this would come istislah, welfare. And after this would come urf, the local custom. Now, Imam Malik rahimullah did not compile his madhab. And nor did he propagate his madhab. It was Imam Malik's students who came after him who propagated his madhab and wrote his madhab down. The first to write the madhab of Imam Malik rahimahullah was Asad ibn Furat. Now Asad ibn Furat had also learned the fiqh of the Hanafis from the students of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. What he did was, he took the questions out of the books of Imam Muhammad, the student of Imam Abu Hanifa. He took the questions from his books, and to these questions, he wrote down the answers of Imam Malik. And this work was known as Mudawwana Ibn Furat. After this, Sahnun came, and he took these masail, and had some rectified, these answers he had some rectified by Ibn al-Qasim. He had some masail rectified by Ibn al-Qasim, and then he sorted this work out. He gave it a good tartib. And at the same time, he made some additions. And this work is known as Mudawwana Sahnun. It contains around 36,000 masail. And according to the Malikiya, this is the basis and the core of their mazhab. So this is basically the second school of thought. Before I briefly continue and finish off, the school of Iraq, the school of Imam Hanifa came to be known as Madrasatul Iraq, the school of Iraq, and the school of Rai, reasoning. And the school of Imam Malik came to be known as Madrasatul Hadith or Madrasatul Madina, the school of Medina or the school of Hadith. Now this does not mean to say that the Hanafis in Iraq did not use Hadith to solve their problems and only relied on Qiyas, analogical deduction. And the people in Madinah al-Munawwara only relied on Hadith and did not use Qiyas. This is completely wrong to believe such a thing. Because the Malikis, the people of Madinah, also used Qiyas, also used reasoning, analogical deduction in areas which were undefined by the Quran and Sunnah. And they used a lot of it. However, in comparison to the Hanafis in Iraq, it was less. This is why one came to be known as Madrasatul Hadith and the other came to be known as Madrasatul Ra'. Now the Hanafis also used Hadith to solve their problems. However, in comparison to the people of Medina, it was less. This is why one came to be known as the school of Hadith and the other came to be known as the school of reasoning. And the reason the Hanafis used more analogical deduction, Qiyas, than the Malikis was, number one, A, because they followed the footsteps of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala an. And Sayyidina Umar and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud favored the wide use of ijtihad in areas undefined by the Quran and Sunnah. While the people in Medina followed the footsteps of Abdullah ibn Umar. And Abdullah ibn Umar was the one who avoided personal interpretations as a general practice. Secondly, life in Medina al-Munawwara was very easy. There was very less problems. Because there was less problems, less solutions required. Thus, less in need of chaos, analogical deduction to solve the problem. Now, Iraq was the capital of the Islamic State at the time, and the center for all these different cultures. And because there was more problems in Iraq, thus there was more in need of chaos to solve the problem. Thirdly, Madinatul Munawwara was the homeland of Rasulullah ﷺ, and many Sahaba resided in Madinatul Munawwara. Thus there was more hadith in Medina. And because there was no fitna in Madinatul Munawwara, they were able to rely on them hadith without a problem. Now in Iraq, the matter was on the contrary. Now in Iraq, what happened was, that was the birthplace of the fabrication of hadith. All the fitna started from Iraq. Now because the fitna started in Iraq and there was fabrication taking place in Iraq, the scholars of Iraq, the Hanafi scholars, put strict conditions before they accepted the hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ. And they would only accept the hadith if it fitted the criteria and fulfilled the conditions. And finally, the fiqh of Imam Malik was very simple. Imam Malik didn't concentrate on hypothetical problems. While Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah concentrated on hypothetical problems, thus they were in need of more qiyas than Imam Malik was. So this is basically why one school is called Madrasatul Ra'i, and one school became to be known as Madrasatul Hadith. Quickly moving on to the third madhab. The third madhab was founded by Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, and it is basically an offspring of the first two. Why? Because Imam Shafi'i was benefited from the students of Imam Abu Hanifa, he benefited from Imam Muhammad rahimahullah, and he also benefited from the masters of the school of Medina. He directly learned under Imam Malik rahimahullah himself. This Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah was able to combine the fiqh of Iraq with the fiqh of Medina and come out with a certain madhab, in where he differed with both of these two. So this is the basis of the fiqh of Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah. And Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah himself combined his madhab and himself compiled his madhab and propagated it far and wide, and he would dictate it to his students. The dictations that he made in Iraq is known in the books as the old madhab, Madhabul Jadid. When he came to Misr, Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah benefited from masters like Layth ibn Sa'd. Now, he benefited from masters like Layth ibn Sa'd.